हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू अनदर लेक्चर ऑन इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ स्टैट्यूट्स। टुडे इज़ द फाइनल लेक्चर ऑन इंडियन जुडिशियल डॉक्ट्रिन्स। वी विल कंक्लूड ऑल द डॉक्ट्रिन्स, द रेस्ट ऑफ द डॉक्ट्रिन्स इन टुडेज सेशन। सो दीज आर द थ्री डॉक्ट्रिन्स फॉर टुडेज सेशन। फर्स्ट इज डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ लैचेस, द सेकेंड इज डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ वेवर, एंड द थर्ड एंड द फाइनल डॉक्ट्रिन इज डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ रिपग्नेंसी। लेट अस बिगिन बाई अंडरस्टैंडिंग वॉट इज डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ लैचेस। The doctrine of laches is a legal defense that may be claimed in a civil matter which asserts that there have been a failure to bring a legal claim in a proper time, that is, an unreasonable delay in pursuing the claim or filing of the lawsuit has been done and it has prejudiced the defendant and it prevents him from putting on a correct and a proper defense. So when anybody who has rights, whose rights has been infringed, it is his duty that he brings upon the matter in a reasonable and proper time. If he fails to do so, then the doctrine of laches would apply, and so there has been a failure to bring a legal claim in a proper time, so then the doctrine of laches is a legal defense as claimed by the defendant. The doctrine of laches is an equitable defense that seeks to prevent a party from ambushing someone else by failing to make a legal claim in a timely manner, that is, there has been an undue delay in asserting a legal right. Because it is an equitable remedy, laches is a form of estoppel. So the doctrine of laches, we can say that it is a form of estoppel as well. And although the person has the right, the plaintiff has the right to, although the plaintiff's right has been infringed, but since he did not bring up the claim in a proper time, then he is stopped to make the claim now. The doctrine of laches is based upon the maxim vigilantibus non dormientis equitas subventil. The doctrine of laches is based upon this maxim, and it means that equity aids to the vigilant and not the ones who slept over their rights. So you have to be vigilant enough to claim whatever infringement has been done to you in a proper time, and if you were sleeping over your rights, then you will lose the opportunity to claim your rights. That is doctrine of laches. So this is the maxim upon which the doctrine of laches is based. So in our Indian legal language, we understand that Limitation Act 1963, where although the person has the legal right, but it is still because of the Limitation Act, because of the bar that the Limitation Act puts, the aggrieved party is not entitled to put up the matter in the court. So in the court, unreasonable delay is not admissible, and hence the doctrine of laches is applied, and this is called as Limitation Act 1963. So there are three elements that needs to be there to apply doctrine of laches. If these three elements are met, then the doctrine of laches will act as the bar in the court. So what are these three laches? Unreasonable lapse of time, unreasonable delay of time, neglect to assert a right or claim, or to the detriment of another, the last point. Now, what is unreasonable lapse of time? My right has been infringed today, and और मैं अगर अभी ये केस फाइल ना करूं, अभी ना करूं, से 5 दिन के अंदर, 10 दिन के अंदर, 1 महीने के अंदर, जो भी लिमिटेशन है मेरे पास, 6 महीने के अंदर मैं केस ना करूं, और मैं जो भी अपनी राइट है उसको मैं 20 ईयर्स लेटर डाउन द लाइन मैं उसको फाइल करूं अपना केस, कि 2010 में मेरे साथ मेरा ये लीगल राइट इन्फ्रिंज हुआ था और अब मैं उसको 2030 में उसका मैं केस फाइल करूँ. सो देयर इज एन अनरीजनेबल डिले of time, unreasonable lapse of time. When, so this is the first element. This is what unreasonable delay of time is, unreasonable lapse of time is. जब कोई reason नहीं है, कोई value, कोई viable, कोई valid reason नहीं है regarding the delay of time. And if the somebody is able to prove कि ये जो delay है वो unreasonable नहीं है, वो delay क्यों था, तो condonation of delay भी एक petition होता है, where the delay is although unreasonable, although long, but the court holds that the delay was not unreasonable and there was a reason, so the court, the petition of condonation of delay is accepted by the court and the aggrieved party is allowed to file the case. So the doctrine of laches का एक एक्सेप्शन हम कह सकते हैं कि कॉन्डोनेशन ऑफ डीले पिटिशन जो हम फाइल करते हैं. नाउ नेग्लेक्ट टू असर्ट अ राइट और क्लेम, सो दिस फॉलोज द फर्स्ट एलिमेंट. द अनरीजनेबल डिले ऑफ टाइम अगर होगा तो ऑब्वियसली देयर हैज बीन अ नेग्लेक्ट ऑन द पार्ट ऑफ द अग्रीव पार्टी टू असर्ट और टू अवर्ट हिज राइट और क्लेम. सो बोथ दीज कॉम्प्लीमेंट ईच अदर. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल अनरीजनेबल डिले होना चाहिए फ्रॉम द अग्रीव पार्टी साइड टू फाइल द केस, टू फाइल द मैटर ऑफ हिज इन्फ्रिंजमेंट, टू ब्रिंग अप द मैटर ऑफ हिज इन्फ्रिंजमेंट इन द नोटिस, एंड देन टू सो एंड इन अ वे दैट ही हैज इन अ वे ही हैज निग्लेक्टेड वट एवर राइट्स वट एवर क्लेम ही हैड ओवर दैट इन्फ्रिंजमेंट. सो बोथ दीज एलिमेंट्स एंड टू द डेट्रीमेंट ऑफ अनदर. This is to the detriment of another. Here, another is the party who is on the wrong side, the party who has actually done wrong, the defendant. So, the detriment of the another. So, जो immovable properties के भी case में होता है कि अगर 20 years तक adverse position हो possession हो जाए तो although वो उनका property नहीं होता है लेकिन वो property हम third party का मान लेते हैं, और अगर जो plaintiff है वो case 20 years later करेंगे तो उसको हम नहीं मानते हैं. वो केस भले वो प्रॉपर्टी प्लेंटिफ का ही हो लेकिन चूंकि 20 इयर्स का टाइम लैप्स बीत चुका है तो वो अनरीजनेबल डिले माना जाता है, और जो डिफेंडेंट है जो रॉन्ग पार्टी है पर उसको वो जो इमूवेबल प्रॉपर्टी है उसका राइट उन डिफेंडेंट को जो रॉन्ग पार्टी है उनको दे दिया जाता है. सो दिस इज द थर्ड पॉइंट, टू द डेट्रीमेंट ऑफ द अनदर. सो जो अब डिफेंडेंट है वो इस तरीके से मिक्सअप हो चुके हैं उस रॉन्ग एक्टिविटी, उस रॉन्ग एक्ट, उस रॉन्ग ऑब्जेक्ट के साथ कि अब उनके साथ वो गलत हो जाएगा, टू हिज डेट्रीमेंट हो जाएगा अगर हम डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ लैच को अप्लाई नहीं करेंगे. सो दीज थ्री एलिमेंट्स आर टू बी मेट, then only the doctrine of latches would apply, would act as a bar in the court. Unreasonable delay of time, neglect to assert a right or a claim, and to the detriment of another or the party who has been doing wrong. So this is doctrine of latches. Now we move on to another doctrine, that is doctrine of waiver. This is a very important doctrine. This doctrine explains that any person who is entitled to any right or privilege can waive the privilege if done so with free will. So doctrine of waive करना मतलब वो जो पार्टी है जिसके पास भी, जो पर्सन है जिसके पास भी कोई प्रिविलेज या कोई राइट है, ही कैन वेव द प्रिविलेज इफ डन विद फ्री विल. वो अपने प्रिविलेज को छोड़ सकते हैं, उसको उसको बोल सकते हैं कि आई नो लॉन्गर पोजेस, आई नो लॉन्गर हैव दैट मच दैट प्रिविलेज दैट आई डो आई नो लॉन्गर पोजेस और हैव दैट प्रिविलेज और राइट, एंड आई डू सो विथ माई फ्री विल. दिस इज डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ वेवर. So it operates on the assumption that the man is the best judge of his interest under any legal liability and he has the knowledge with while intentionally giving up the privilege. और ये किस assumption पे based है doctrine of waiver, कि man जो है वो best judge है अपने interest का. तो कोई भी आदमी अपना कोई नुकसान जानबूझ के नहीं करेंगे. So the man is the best judge of his own interest and जो भी उनका नॉलेज है वो इंटेंशनली अपने नॉलेज से, अपने फ्री विल से कभी भी अपने प्रिविलेज एंड राइट को अपने डेट्रीमेंट के, अपने अगेंस्ट यूज नहीं करेंगे, गिव अप नहीं करेंगे. सो दिस इज डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ वेवर, वेयर एनी मैन एनी पर्सन इज एंटाइटल्ड टू गिव अप ऑन हिज राइट एंड प्रिविलेज प्रोवाइडेड ही इज डूइंग सो ऑन फ्री विल. सो देर इज ऑलवेज बीन अ डिबेट वेदर यू कैन the doctrine of right can the person waive off his fundamental rights. So can the if all the rights can be waived off, can anybody waive off his fundamental rights. So this is a debate that has been ongoing, and we can say that now after so many cases it has been concluded, it has after many cases, after many interpretation given by various judges in various judgments, it has been now concluded that it is not open to a citizen to waive the fundamental rights. These rights have been enacted in the Constitution of India, and these rights are not to be seen as an individual rights. It is to be seen as a public policy. So, these are held, fundamental rights are held to be as public policy, and therefore, doctrine of waiver would not apply in terms of fundamental rights. So, this is the question, can fundamental rights under the Indian Constitution be waived off? and this question that it arose in the case of Behram versus state of Madhya Pradesh, sorry, Maharashtra, where it is held that the rights are of two kinds, the ones that confer benefits to the individual and the ones that give benefit to general public. So the majority opinion in this case was that fundamental rights were kept in the constitution as a public policy for the benefit to the general public as a public policy and not merely as an individual benefit. So it was held in this case, it was decided in this case that the fundamental rights cannot be waived off and anybody cannot cannot just give up his fundamental rights just like that, or even though his free will is involved. Now, Basheshwar Nath versus Commissioner of Income Tax, we can say that this is a landmark judgment as far as doctrine of waiver is concerned. Basheshwar Nath versus Commissioner of Income Tax, the petitioner had made a settlement with the Commissioner of the Income Tax after the Commissioner had decided to take a certain amount as his concealed income. He had agreed to pay 3 lakhs as penalty and for his arrears of tax. But the Supreme Court held that Section 5 Subclause 1 of the Taxation of Income Investigation Commission Act was ultra vires of Article 14 of the Constitution, and if Section 1 Subclause 5 of the Taxation of Income would have to be applied, then Article 14 would have to be waived off by any person. And Article 14 is what? It is a fundamental rights of given under Indian Constitution. And since fundamental rights cannot be waived off, since it is a public policy and it is not for the individual benefit, so no person can waive off Article 14, and then and therefore Article 5(1) of the Taxation of Income cannot be applied, and it is ultra vires of Article 14 of the Constitution. So Basheshwar Nath versus Commissioner of Income Tax, a very important judgment as far as doctrine of waiver is concerned. Now there is another very important aspect to this doctrine of waiver. We all must have heard about the Aruna Schonborg case, where the passive euthanasia has been given a positive nod by the Supreme Court. So in Aruna Schonborg case, it was held that since Article 21, so euthanasia is what? Right to die, right to kill somebody. So this is incomplete and in violation of Article 21, that is right to life. So Aruna Schonborg mein, it was held that rights of Article 21 can be read in the context of the right to die with dignity. So राइट अरुणा शॉनबर्ग केस में जो उसने पैथिव यूथनेशिया को लीगल बनाया था, उसमें पैथिव यूथनेशिया डज नॉट गिव यू द राइट टू किल योर सेल्फ, डज नॉट गिव द राइट टू समबडी कि वो किसी को भी मार दें, बिकॉज ये फ्री विल है, वो पर्सन बोल रहा है कि मुझे मार दो और मैंने उसको मार दिया. नो, दिस इज नॉट द केस. सो अरुणा शॉनबर्ग में ये हेल्ड किया गया था कि आर्टिकल 21 में जो बोला गया है कि आर्टिकल 21 इज राइट टू लाइफ, सो इट हैज टू बी इंटरप्रेटेड इन अ वे दैट anybody who has a right to life has a right to die with dignity, और उनके पास मरने का भी ऐसा right है कि वो एक dignity और एक अच्छे ढंग से और एक अच्छे state में रहे और वो एक dignity के साथ मरे. So the apex court legalized passive euthanasia employing withdrawal of life support of the patients in the permanent vegetative state. So if anybody is in permanent vegetative state, in coma for many years, since she was in the vegetative states in since many years, so the court held that she has a right to die with dignity, and it is not in violation of Article 21, but it is the another interpretation of Article 21, that is right to life. So because it was argued that the continued existence of any such patient is the violation of their right to live with dignity, right to die with dignity. So Aruna Schonborg में जो passive euthanasia को court ने legalize किया था, वो Article 21 के against नहीं था, वो Article 21 के ही interpretation को उन्होंने आगे बढ़ाया था कि right to life includes right to live with dignity and so right to die with dignity comes along with it. This application of the doctrine of waiver on the fundamental rights should be done with a bona fide intention for the individual. सो यहाँ पे बोनाफाइड इंटेंशन होना चाहिए टू अप्लाई डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ वेवर ऑन द फंडामेंटल राइट्स. तो अरुणा शानबाग केस में दिस वॉज हेल्ड. And this is a very important this aspect of to understand doctrine of waiver. Can fundamental rights be waived off? This point, it is very important to understand Aruna Schoenberg case and read it along with the lines of Article 21. So this was a doctrine of waiver where anybody can give up his rights, his privilege, but in general fundamental rights cannot be waived off because fundamental rights are considered to be as public policy and not for something for individual benefit. Now we come to the last doctrine out of all the 11 doctrines that we discussed. This is the last doctrine of today's session as well, and in the Indian judicial doctrines the whole session. Doctrine of repugnancy. Article 254 of the Constitution of India, it says, it talks about doctrine of repugnancy in India. So Article 254 mein doctrine of repugnancy ki baat kahi gayi hai. What do we mean by repugnancy? Repugnancy is defined as an inconsistency ya contradiction ya conflict between two and more parts of a legal instrument, that is any statute or contract. So repugnancy, we can say this, any conflict ya any inconsistency between two or more parts of any statute. So what are the conditions that needs to be satisfied before any repugnancy could arise? So these are the three conditions. Pehla, there has to be a clear and direct conflict and inconsistency between the Central Act and the State Act. तो सेंट्रल ने कोई एक्ट बनाया रिगार्डिंग एनी पर्टिकुलर थीम, स्टेट ने भी वही एक लॉ बनाया उसी थीम के लेकर एक लॉ बनाया, और उन दोनों लॉ में एक क्लियर और डिस्टिंक्ट इनकन्सिस्टेंसी होनी चाहिए, और वो जो इनकन्सिस्टेंसी है शुड बी एब्सोल्यूटली इरिकॉन्सिएबल. तो वो दोनों इनकन्सिस्टेंसी जो दोनों एक्ट है वो ऐसा नहीं हो सकता कि वो दोनों एक्ट को एक साथ पढ़ा जा सके, वो दोनों एक्ट बिल्कुल एब्सोल्यूटली मिल नहीं सकते हैं और दोनों बिल्कुल मिल नहीं सकते हैं, बिल्कुल मिक्सअप नहीं हो सकते हैं. सो फर्स्ट देर शुड बी अ क्लियर एंड डायरेक्ट इनकन्सिस्टेंसी बिटवीन बोथ द सेंट्रल एंड स्टेट एक्ट, एंड द सेकेंड पॉइंट इज दैट सच इनकन्सिस्टेंसी शुड बी एब्सोल्यूटली इरिकॉन्सिएबल. And that the inconsistency between the provisions of the two acts is of such nature as to bring the two acts into direct collision with each other, and a situation is reached where it is impossible to obey the one without disobeying the other. So, अगर वो दोनों irreconcilable हैं, तो अगर हम एक को follow करेंगे, तो मतलब हम दूसरे को infringe करेंगे, और अगर हम दूसरे को follow करेंगे, तो हम पहले को infringe करेंगे. तो एकदम absolutely irreconcilable है, वो बिल्कुल मिल नहीं सकते हैं, वो बिल्कुल inconsistent है, और clear और direct inconsistency हो. उन केसेस में डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ रिपग्नेंसी अप्लाई होता है. तो दिस इज व्हाट आर्टिकल 254 टॉक्स अबाउट व्हेन देयर इज अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट एंड कॉन्ट्रडिक्शन बिटवीन द टू एक्ट्स, सेंट्रल एंड स्टेट एक्ट. नाउ एम करुणा निधि वर्सेस यूनियन ऑफ इंडिया, दिस इज द केस वेयर द डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ रिपग्नेंसी वॉज प्रॉपरली अजर्ज्ड एंड इट वॉज प्रॉपरली गिवन डेफिनेशन टू. सो there are certain very important points. I will just brief it out. The first, we can say that if there is a conflict between a central act and the state act regarding any particular law, any in the concurrent list, so then the central act will prevail. So if there are conflict between the provisions of central act and the state act in the concurrent list, then the central act would prevail over the state act. Second point hai ki the state act jo hai shall prevail to the extent of repugnancy provided that the state act has been passed in accordance with the provisions in accordance with clause 2 of article 254. To agar jo state comes a law that has been passed by the state comes into collision with a law passed by the parliament on the entry in the concurrent list, to state act ko hum us end tak manenge sahi jahan pe jitne bhi points wo repugnant honge us extent tak hum unko repugnant maan denge jo bhi wo conflicting honge, aur अगर वो प्रॉपरली पास आउट हुए होंगे, प्रॉपरली पास हुए होंगे अकॉर्डिंग टू 254 ऑफ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, तो स्टेट एक्ट प्रिवेल करेगा बट ओनली टू द एक्सटेंड ऑफ रिपग्नेंसी. द थर्ड इज वेयर हाउएवर अ लॉ दैट हैज बीन मेड बाय द स्टेट लेजिस्लेचर ऑन अ सब्जेक्ट दैट इज कवर्ड इन द कॉन्करेंट लिस्ट इज इनकन्सिस्टेंट एंड रिपग्नेंट टू द प्रीवियस लॉ मेड बाय द पार्लियामेंट, देन सच लॉ कैन बी प्रोटेक्टेड बाय ऑब्टेनिंग द असेंट ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट. सो दिस इज़ द थर्ड एंड अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट वेर इट स्टेट्स दैट कि अगर स्टेट लेजिस्लेचर ने कोई लॉ बनाया ऑन अ सब्जेक्ट फ्रॉम द कॉन्करेंट लिस्ट जो कि इनकन्सिस्टेंट है या रिपग्नेंट है टू द प्रीवियसली मेड लॉ, पार्लियामेंट में जो पहले लॉ प्रीवियसली मेड लॉ जो था जो पार्लियामेंट में था, तो हम स्टेट लॉ को तब प्रोटेक्ट कर सकते हैं कि मतलब अगर पार्लियामेंट ने ऑलरेडी कोई लॉ बना दिया है और स्टेट ने फिर उसके बाद जाके कॉन्करेंट लिस्ट में किसी मैटर पे कोई लॉ बनाया है और उसके बाद कॉन्फ्लिक्ट है, तो हम स्टेट लेजिस्लेचर को फिर भी वैलिड करा सकते हैं। कैसे करा सकते हैं? बाय ऑब्टेनिंग द असेंट दैट इज द सिग्नेचर द वैलिडिटी द पॉजिटिव नॉड फ्रॉम द प्रेजिडेंट अंडर आर्टिकल 254 सब क्लॉज 2 ऑफ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन। So, M. Karunanidhi versus Union of India in details talks about when and how Central Act will prevail, when and how State Act will prevail, how to get validity for the acts that has been passed by the state legislature. This is a landmark judgment as far as doctrine of repugnancy is concerned. With this, we come to end of today's session. So, today we complete the Indian judicial doctrines on the whole. I hope you all are clear with all the doctrines. If any doubt, kindly raise it in the comments below. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.